لله رب العالمين، الصلاة والسلام صلي على رسوله الكريم، أما بعد، أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. The Book of Zakat، كتاب الزكاة، Part 1 in English. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الصلاة والسلام على سيدنا المرسلين والعاقبة للمتقين، أما بعد. Here, next to prayer, zakat is the most important role of Islam. It has been mentioned in Quran 82 times. It was an obligatory payment to in case of the, we have to follow it. It is a compulsory, it's a mandatory thing mentioned in the Quran. الَّذِينَ يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ حَقًّا. This is mentioned in Surah Al-Anfal. And who establish regular prayers and spend freely out of the gifts we have given them of sustenance, such in truth are the believers. Similarly, in Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah Ta'ala says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ وَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَآتُوا الزَّكَاةَ and لَهُمْ أَجْرُهُمْ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ وَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. Those who believe and do deeds of righteousness and establish regular prayer and regular charity will have their reward with their Lord. On them shall be no fear nor their grief. Payment of zakat is good means of attainment of all sin and increase in the grades of dignity. Merciful Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, خُذُوا مِنْ أَمْوَالِهِمْ صَدَقَاتُ تَطَحِّرُوهُمْ وَتُزَكِّيهِمْ بِهَا. This is in chapter number 103, ayah number 9. Of their chapter number 9, ayah number 103, sorry, of their goods like alms, so that you might test, purify and sanctify them. By paying zakat, not only sins are forgiven, but also increase in wealth is promised by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, not only like increase in the which increase in the wealth and purify it. So here we see further one more in chapter number 30 and ayah number 39, وَمَا آتَاتُمْ مِنْ زَكَاتٍ تُرِيدُونَ وَجْهَ لِلَّهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُضْعِفُونَ. That which you lay out for charity seeking the countenance of Allah, that is face of Allah, pleasure of Allah will increase. It is these who will get the recompense multiplied. Mud'afina, it's from the of, you know, it will increase, multiply, multifold, double or more, like Allah alam how much more it will be. The literal meaning of zakat is to purify and enhancement. In other words, by paying a zakat. Zakat is, you know, it's a tazkiyah. So, purifying oneself. His wealth also obtains religious sanction for his possessions and his soul to his cleanse all sorts of wickedness and filth. From another angle, there is increase in wealth as well as divine reward. Along with the blessings and bounties attached to the payment of zakat, it is worthwhile to keep in mind the ill effect attendant upon its non-payment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has declared in the Quran the non-payment of zakat as a sign of polytheism. وَيْلٌ لِلْمُشْرِكِينَ الَّذِينَ لَا يُؤْتُونَ الزَّكَاةَ وَهُمْ بِالْآخِرَةِ هُمْ كَافِرُونَ. This is in chapter number 41, ayah number 6 and 7. And woe to those who join Allah with those who pay not zakat and who even deny the hereafter. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam stated that wealth of those who do not pay zakat is eventually destroyed. This is in Tabrani. In another tradition, it stated that such people are made to suffer famine. This is in also in Tabrani. Apart from the misery and ruin faced in this world, the punishment that will be meted out to such people in the hereafter is described in the Quran. وَالَّذِينَ يَكْنِزُونَ الزَّهْبَ وَالْفِدَّةَ وَالْيُنْفِقُونَهَا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. This is in chapter number 9, ayah number 34 and 35. And there are those who are gold and silver and spend it not in the way of Allah. Announce unto them a most grievous penalty on the day when heat will be produced out of that wealth in the fire of hell, and with it will be branded their foreheads. Their foreheads will be branded, their flanks and their backs. This is the treasure which you buried for yourself. Taste you the treasure of your buried. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam stated that on the day of judgment, the wealth of those who have not paid the zakat will be turned into a bald snake, most venomous, which will bite them continuously and say, I am your wealth. This is in Bukhari. For non-payment of zakat in the relation to with the animals, he stated sallallahu alaihi wasallam, those animals will hit their masters with their horns and trample them under their feet continuously for 50,000 years on the day of judgment. This is in Muslim. In the night of ascension, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Miraj, saw some people in the tatters, and like animals they were eating thorns and stones of the hell. When asked about it to the angel, Jibreel said, these are the people who fail to pay the zakat on their wealth bazaar. Be it noted that the punishment mentioned in the above verses of the Quran and tradition applies not to the hedonists but to the Muslims who do not pay the zakat. Their prayer and fasting notwithstanding, said the Messenger of Allah, and pay zakat so that your Islam becomes complete.
Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Welcome you all. Fahmul Quran, inshallah. We'll continue. We completed Suratul Nahl. Inshallah, today we're going to do Juz 15 and we're going to do Suratul Isra. Let's see the introduction of the Suratul Isra. Suratul Isra, this is in Juz 15. Some call it the Bani Israel, or you can call it Suratul Isra also. The both ways it's correct. And this surah, it has 111 ayahs, verses. And this surah is a Makki surah. So you have seen Makki and Madani, there is a different style of surahs. Like in Makki surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about Tawheed, Islamic monotheism, oneness of Islam. So we'll see in detail about it. And here in Makki surah, the things and the persecution was severe. This surah was revealed 1 year before Hijrah, migration to Medina, on the occasion of Miraj. Miraj means ascension, during the last period of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam at Makkah. And the things will be discussed in this surah is Isra and Miraj. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tour of the universe and divine commandments, worship none but Allah. Means la ilaha illallah. Be kind and obedient to parents. You know, the dua will be there. Rabbir hamhuma kama rabbayani saghira. And give to relatives and needy. Do not be a miser or spendthrift. Do not kill your children for fear of poverty. Do not commit adultery. Do not slay without just cause. Do not say anything without knowledge, especially about deen. Do not walk arrogantly on earth. Safeguard the property of orphans. Allah does not beget children, and those who say this is utter a monstrous lie. So when people say Allah has son or daughter, Allah don't like it. And that is a lie. There is surely a life after death. That will be mentioned. The obligation of 5 daily prayer and the prayer of tahajjud, especially late night prayer. Humans are sent as rasools to human beings. Perform salah in a voice which is neither too loud or too soft. So salah should be like, you know, how we do jahri salah and sirri salah with the jamaat. That also is like, you know, beauty of our salah. Sometimes we are saying loudly and we could hear, and sometimes silently. That's how the things are. So let's begin. Nahmadul nusalli ala rasulihil kareem amma baad fawz billahi min shaitan jim bismillah rahman rahim. So here suratul isra, it starts with subhanallazi, praising Allah subhanallah ta'ala. Subhanallazi asra bi abdihi laylam minal masjid al harami ila al masjid al aqsa allazi barakna hawlahu linuriyahu min ayatina innahu huwa as-sami'ul basir. Exalted is he, perfect is he, who? Allah, who took his servant by night from al-masjid al-haram to al-masjid al-aqsa, the mosque, whose surrounding we have blessed, barakna. Why was his servant take on journey? To show him to our signs. Indeed, he is hearing the same. 1 year before Prophet ﷺ migrated to Madinah, 1 year before the Hijrah, circumstances in Makkah were becoming increasingly difficult for him. So Prophet ﷺ had by now spent about 12 years in Makkah, calling people to worship alone, Allah alone, and only response he had received in return was refusal. Stubbornness, opposition, violence, mockery, false propaganda, and the list goes on. And with the time, the pressure had only increased. It had intensified. And this is something that saddened the Prophet ﷺ, because, you know, he had been opposed for 12 years, 12 solid years, and the things were not good. And so Allah, with his special mercy, bestowed a huge favor, a huge gift on Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What was the gift? The gift of Isra and the gift of Miraj. What is Isra? The night journey. That in one night, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was taken from Al-Masjid Al-Haram to Masjid Al-Aqsa. Masjid Al-Haram is in Makkah and Masjid Al-Aqsa is in Jerusalem, Palestine. So in one night, he was taken there, taken up to the skies and then back also. This happened in one night. This was a huge favor, huge gift of Allah. And when he was taken to Jerusalem, from there he was taken to the skies above. And this is what is known as Isra and Miraj. In this journey, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was shown numerous signs, as Allah mentioned in the ayah. And these signs, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was shown both in this world and also in the skies above. And this is something that gave confidence to Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It gave him reassurance. And in the journey, we learned that I'm so sorry. I hope the voice is okay. So let's continue. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajeem. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. So in this journey, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was shown numerous signs, as Allah mentioned in this ayah. And this signs, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was shown both in this world and also in the skies above. And this is something that gave confidence to Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It gave him reassurance. He was shown Jannah and Jahannam, and he was shown the various punishment that people were being given. So this journey was not an REM that we are in right now, because many people, when they have learned about this part of the life of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they find it difficult to understand, because we are thinking about in worldly terms. How could you possibly travel in one night all the way to Jerusalem and the skies above and across, and then be back while the bed is still warm? Yes, it can happen. Not according to the laws of physics that we are aware, but this was a huge favor of Allah. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Subhanallazi. Perfect is Allah, because for him, anything is possible. For him, anything is easy. If he wants to take a servant in one night and back and forth from the sky and down. He can do that. It's not difficult for him. Why? Why would it be difficult for him? Because if you just observe the creation, I mean, if you look at the massive size of this universe alone and realize that all this came about from nothing. So Allah can make anything, right? Like 500 years ago, if you told something about, you know, germs or anything, bacteria or anything, you know, people would laugh. Now they believe it because scientific proof and so on. But here, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, this was a miracle thing that happened. So Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he was told, he was taken on Burakh and is a creature. It is a creature, means it's a different kind of creature that is bigger than a mule, smaller than a horse. So it looked like a horse, but it's not actually a horse. And now, where did the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam say that it had, like he said that it has wings, but it had wings. Yes, it would have to move its wings in order to fly. But the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that its speed was the speed of sight. The speed of sight means speed of vision, meaning its next step would be as far as the vision would go. You understand? So that's how, like, you know, a rocket, or, you know, how the fast it will be. So Subhanallah, perfect is Allah, the one who bestowed this huge favor on his messenger. And in the journey, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when he returned with some gifts and some messages for us. What were the gifts? We learned that Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was given three things on this journey. He was given 5 daily prayers, which were initially 50. Then on Musa al-Islam recommendation, what happened? It was reduced to half, then less and less, eventually until it was 5. And Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam felt shy to have it decrease any further. So he returned with the gift of 5 daily prayers, which means that before the Isra, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam prayed, but he did not pray 5 daily prayers because the command was not there. And at the time, Allah gifted him the gift of the prayer. Why? Because he needed this gift the most at this time. Because when you are facing the opposition of people, when you feel all alone, when you feel like your efforts are hardly producing any positive results, then what do you need? You need to strengthen your iman, your faith in Allah. You need to beg Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You need to calm your heart by pouring out your heart, your fears, your worries before whom? Before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not in front of any other person. You need to connect with the one who made you, the one for whom everything is possible. And what better way of connecting with Allah and through salah? When you talk to Allah and Allah listens to you and Allah hears you. So Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam returned with the gift of salat and also concluding verses of Surah Al-Baqarah. The concluding verses of Surah Al-Baqarah, the last two ayahs of Surah Al-Baqarah were given to Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam up there. Jibreel alaihi wasallam was not sent down with those verses. Rather, he was called up in order to receive those verses. And that shows us the value of these verses, which is why Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that whoever recites them in the night, then these verses will be sufficient for him. Sufficient for him means, you know, to deal with all these worries, fears, anxiety, to protect him, and also for the worship of the night, because these verses are no ordinary verses, and also with the gift of forgiveness for those among the ummah and do not associate anything with Allah, then ultimately Allah will forgive every single muhid, the one who believes in tawheed, that Allah and the God is one, Allah is one, and have no partners, means not doing shirk. So we are doing Surah Al-Isra, juz number 15. I am giving the introduction of that. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was also met certain prophets, like, for example, he met Ibrahim al-Islam. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I met Ibrahim on the night journey, and he said, O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, say my salam to Ummah. Are you a part of the Ummah? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, like, you know, we are the part of the Ummah. Assalamu alaikum, wa alaikum salam, right? Ibrahim alaihi wasallam, amazing man. Look at how grateful he was, how patient he has, so much sabr. Then we learn his dua that, O Allah, forgive me and forgive all the believers. And when he meets Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, give my salam to Ummah. Subhanallah. So, like, how generous, how, like, you know, he is always concerned for the nation, Ibrahim al-Islam. Ibrahim al-Islam say, my salam to Ummah, and tell them that Jannah has good fertile soil, you know, and sweet water, but it is barren, you know, meaning work need to be done. So Jannah is barren means what? You know, we need to do some work, isn't it? And we know this hadith. Many times we heard it and we know this is the hadith. But are we doing, are we really working on it or not? So what is the thing we have to do? We have to, yes, we have to do zikr. Zikr will make the plants grow over there. We want plants in this world, isn't it? But what about the plants in the hereafter? For the hereafter, you should do the zikr. So here, Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, La ilaha illallah, Wallahu Akbar. These are the plantation. These are the, zikr. We have to do, we have to keep our tongue moist with the zikr of Allah Subhanallah Ta'ala. And zikr is such a thing, you know, it also gives you peace and tranquility to your heart. Many times, you know, we are dependent on the pills or this or that. Why don't we do zikr? Zikr is the beautiful thing. We all need that, and it will calm your heart many times. You know, right now also, if you try it, it soothes your heart. It calms your heart. And, you know, here in Jannah, the plantation will be, we all want plants. We also keep, you know, in our home, we do plants at home also, isn't it? We learned that Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said during the Miraj, I saw a group of people who were scratching their chest, you know, the another hadith, and their face with the copper nail. I asked, who are these people? Jibreel al-Islam, he asked. So these are the people who ate the flesh of others. How the people eat flesh of others? Yes, that's right, backbite, trample people's honor. You know, not only people backbited, even trample people's honor. How people trample the honor of the others, you know, talking about bad about them, humiliating them, not only in front, in back of them. Another punishment which Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was shown, he said, I was taken for the journey and I passed by a group of people whose lips were being cut by scissor. Means such a huge lips. Being cut by scissor of fire, and that scissor is made of fire. I asked, who are they? And he was told, they are Qataba. And are the people of the world, meaning the speakers who gives khutbah, the orators, the lecturers, you know, the one who convey the deen, those who would order people to do good but forget themselves. So for the da'i, it has a big responsibility, just saying the things, but they have to implement it actually. They are the those who read the book. Do they not understand? They don't. Actually, they don't implement it. So these are the things we have to remember. Let's move to ayah number 2, Suratul Isra. We are doing juz 15. And we gave Musa the scripture and made it guidance for the children of Israel. And do not take other than me as a disposer of affairs. O descendants of those whom we carried in the ship with Noah, indeed he was a grateful servant. So Allah reminds Bani Israel that look at you, who your parents were, your ancestors were. You are the children of believers, those who survived. You know, Allah is reminding of the great flood at the time of Nuh al-Islam. You are the children. And who was the Nuh? He was a grateful servant. So what they should do? They should be grateful. And we convey to the children of Israel in the scripture that you will be surely cause corruption on the earth twice. And you will surely reach a degree, great pride and haughtiness. Ayah number 5, Suratul Isra. So when the time of promise came for the first of them, we sent against you servants of ours, those of great military might, meaning your enemy was stronger than you. You know, the first occasion of fasad, the first time spread corruption on the earth, what happened? Send against people who are mightier than you, stronger than you. They probed even into the homes, meaning they spread everywhere. Everywhere in your lands, they fully exalted, and it was a promise fulfilled. Ayah number 6, Suratul Isra, then we gave back to you a written victory over them. Means look at how Allah changes the night into day. Why is it that Allah changed the condition of Bani Israel now? What happened? they committed great fasad. They caused a great corruption. And then what happened? Allah sent people against them. And these people, they ruined them completely. And when Bani Israel did their Islah, they reformed themselves. Then what happened? Allah gave them victory again. And Allah gave them victory. What do we learn from this? That we suffer when our sins increases. We suffer in this world when our sins are multiplied. When we have moved away from what Allah has ordered us to do. When we are creating corruption on the land. Like, you know, disturbing the lives of people, cheating them, harming them, spreading corruption. This is something that will cause us to suffer and make our lives difficult and miserable. So otherwise, remember that those who believe in Allah, they will always be victorious regardless of their number. The only situation when they will not be victorious is when their sins are greater than the sins of their enemy, when their akhlaq is worse than the akhlaq of their enemy. And that is what we need to be thinking about right now, that we complain a lot about overall condition of Muslims over the world, but we forget to reflect on ourselves. We have to reflect on ourselves because we will be answerable to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we reinforce you with wealth and sons and made you more numerous in manpower. This was the thing given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In ahsantum ahsantum li anfusikum, ayah number 7, if you do good, you do good for yourself, meaning when you reform yourself, when you fix your behavior, who do you benefit? Yourself. So you have to fix yourself. You know better. You know, every person, they know their weakness. So in ahsantum ahsantum li anfusikum wa in aslamtum falaha. And if you do evil, you do it for yourself. You know, somebody is doing evil, and sometimes we know, we say, oh, that they are doing, so we want to follow. Why we want to follow? If they are doing evil, may Allah guide them. But we shouldn't follow the evil way. We should follow Quran and Sunnah, isn't it? Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if any one of you improve his deen, meaning his obedience to Allah, then his deeds will be rewarded 10 times to 700 times. Where we learn in Surah Al-Baqarah. For each good deed and bad deed will be recorded as it is. So when a person fix himself, does Islah, like for example, we learn about sabr, patience. So when a person tries to be patient at times, when it's very easy to be angry, it's very easy to be hasty in response, but he or she does sabr. So they get more and more, 10 to 700 times. So, you know, normally doing sabr is easy. But at the time that when the situation are against you, it's really hard. So that time we have to remind ourselves. Then when the final promise came, we sent to your enemies to sadden your faces and to enter the temple as they entered the first time and destroyed it. And to destroy what they had taken over with total destruction. You know, when you regressed, when you went back to your bad ways, you know, all the things, bad habits, all the things, again you started. That's what it means. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala again gave them the destruction. So that's the thing mentioned over here. And ayah number 8, then Allah said, it is expected that if you repent, okay, whatever happened, happened. Now if you repent, your Lord will have mercy upon you. Meaning, if now you repent, Allah will show you mercy, like, you know, Allah will show mercy to you. Because as long as you are living, you make a mistake. You keep going back to Allah. Allah will forgive you. Allah will show mercy to you. So never despair. But if you return to sin, we will return to punishment. And we have made hell for the disbelievers a prison bed. Meaning, even if you manage to survive in this world, you cannot escape the punishment. Inna hazal Qur'ana yahdi lillati hiya aqwam, ayah number 9, Surah Al-Isra. Indeed, this Qur'an guides to that which is most suitable. Meaning, he who wishes to find the right way, the best way in life, through its difficulty and trials, then what is it that he needs to turn to? Qur'an. What is it that he needs to hold on to? The book of Allah, Qur'an. Take the help, you know. إن هذا القرآن يهدي للتي هي أقوى. And it gives a good tidings to the believers who do righteous deeds, and they will have a great reward. And that those who do not believe in the hereafter, we have prepared for them a painful punishment. This matter is very clear. There are two different ways. One way of life is holding on to the book of Allah, Quran, living by the book of Allah. And the other way of life is living by your own desires. Outcome for both is completely different. You know, going to Jannah with the hasra, it's not possible. Going to Jannah with trying, testing, you have to try hard and hard. Ayah number 11. وَيَدُ الْإِنسَانُ بِشَرِّ دُوَاءُهُ بِالْخَيْرِ وَكَانَ الْإِنسَانُ عَجُولًا. And the man supplicate for evil as he supplicates for good, and man is very hasty. Meaning, when he cannot bear hardship of his life, what does he begin to pray for? Death or more problems. He gets so frustrated and he started saying bad things instead of good. You know, for example, something happens. A child, he is, you know, going in a wrong path, for example. And parents, instead of, you know, explaining to him or her in a nice manner, started cursing them. You know, وَيَدُ الْإِنسَانَ بِالشَّرِّ دُوَاءُهُ بِالْخَيْرِ. Instead of khair, they make dua of shar. When they make? When something is going in a wrong direction. So we need to fix it. Because every person, they are, leader on their family. So when you are not taking care of your own family, how is it possible? And that too, you are making a dua of shar instead of khair. Why is it so? وَكَانَ الْإِنسَانَ عَجُولَ. Ajula is from ajulat. They are very hasty. You know, there's a famous saying, everybody knows about it. Like Imam of Haram, he was very naughty, and you know, their parents, they never cursed. They gave dua, Allah make him, for the Haram, the leader of the Haram, and he was given that. So right now, what we are doing, we have to check ourselves. Are we when children are very naughty or going in a different direction, that time also give dua of khair, because Allah listens to us, whatever we are saying. Don't say bad or negative things. And you know, not only parents, anyone, it can be anyone, even old people, young people, any age, doesn't matter who they are. Don't be ajula, don't be hasty. Instead of khair, don't say shar, because we are inviting trouble. Sometimes what happens, you know, we are so tired, we say, oh, like, you know, I should get sick and hospitalized. What is that? What kind of dua is that? Is it a dua or is it a cursing your oneself? Never ever do that. And some people, they say, oh, from like my life is so messed up, I want to have death. You know what death is? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said when he was on the last stage of death, like how severe it will be. For the Prophet, what about us? We are nothing, right? There's no end for it, because in years and years we have to lie down in the grave. And after that, day of judgment. Day of judgment is such a long day. We are not going to escape from anything. And ayah number 12, Surah Al-Isra, we have made the night and two signs. Day and night, they are the signs. Look at the night, look at the day. Like, you know, how it changes. These are the signs. We erased the signs of the night and made the sign of the day visible, that you may seek bounty from your Lord and may know the number of years and the account of time. And everything we have set out in detail. And for every person, we have imposed his fate upon his neck. You know, every person, they have fate in his neck, meaning the deeds that a person has committed and the outcome of those deeds, they are tied to a person. There is no escape from that. Once we do any action, it is recorded in our deeds. And once we have performed any action, its consequence we have to face in this world and the hereafter. So our fate is tied to our neck, and we will produce for him on the day of resurrection a record. which he will encounter spread open. The record will be wide open. And iqra kitabaka, ayah number 14, it will be said, read your record. Sufficient is yourself against you this day as accounted. You know, you will be accounted for yourself and you are sufficient, meaning a person, he can take his own hisab on the day of judgment. And the result will be that obvious. It will be so obvious that a complicated hisab does not need to be done. It's so simple. It will be clear what a person deserves for the life that he has spent. So everything will be recorded. And Surah Al-Adiyah, وَحُسِّلُ مَا فِي الصُّدُورِ, even most hidden things in the heart that a person try to conceal, never expect, even that, not never ever express, even that will be brought out. And here we should ask forgiveness, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The dua of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allahumma ghfirli ma qaddamtu wa ma akhartu wa ma asrartu wa ma alantu wa ma asraftu wa ma anta alamu bihi minni, anta muqaddimu wa anta almuakhiru, la ilaha illa anta. That, oh Allah, forgive me what I have sent ahead, what I have deferred, because there are some bad things that we plan to do, right? We plan to do, but we don't do it. So those I have done secretly, those I have done openly, so and those you know better off than I do. Anta muakhiru, la ilaha illa anta. I don't even know the sins I have committed. So forgive me for all my sins. Make this dua regularly. And there are some du'as in Hisnul Muslim, Fortress of Muslim, and Vayyaka Nasteen, and Quranic and Masnoon du'as. And you can look for the, there's an app also. And there's a hadith, we learned that Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he laughed. Anas bin Malik reported, we were in the company of Allah's Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. When he smiled and he said, do you know why I laughed? We said, Allah and His Messenger know the best. They never used to answer. They said, you know best. He said, it was because they come to my mind the talk which the servants will have with his Lord on the day of judgment. He would say, oh my Lord, have you not guaranteed me protecting against injustice? Meaning you promised that you will, we won't be having zulm on the day of judgment. Allah will say, yes, naam. So the servants will say, then I do not deem valid any witness against me but my own self. You know, we will be witnessing against our own self instead of any other person. So Allah, meaning if you ask anybody else to come and witness against me, I would consider that to be unfair. So only I should be asked about the deeds that I have committed. So Allah will say, well, enough would be the witness of yourself against you, that of two angels who had been appointed to record your deeds, right and left, they are recording. Then the seal would be set upon his mouth, and it would be set to his hands and to feet to speak, and they would speak of his deeds. Then the mouth would be made free to talk. He would say to the hands and feet, be away, let there be curse of Allah upon you. It was for your safety that I contended. You know, that's how it will be. Kafa bi nafsika yawma alayka hasiba. Our body will testify to the action that we have committed. And this was the hadith that was mentioned in Muslim. Surah Al-Isra, ayah number 15. Whoever is guided is only guided for the benefit of his soul. And whoever error, only error against his, because no one will suffer in his place. And no barrier of burdens will bear the burden of another. No, we cannot put our blame on anybody else. And never would we punish until we sent a messenger. You know, after sending messengers, they will be punished. And ayah number 16, and when we intend to destroy a city, we command its affluent, but they defiantly disobey therein. So the word came into effect upon it, and we destroyed it with complete destruction. And how many have we destroyed from the generation after Noah? And sufficient is your Lord, means concerning the sins of his servants, acquainted and seeing. Khabiran basira. Ayah number 18, Surah Al-Isra, whoever should desire the immediate, means man kana yuridul ajila. Immediate meaning he wants the reward for the efforts here right now in this world. Whoever is goal in this world, Allah says, we hasten for him from it that what we will do whom we intend. Meaning, yes, then he will get something of what he wants here in this world. He cannot have in everything. He cannot, you cannot have everything ultimately. We can try all we want, but the result that we get can only be those which Allah allows. And then we have made for him hell, which he will enter to burn, censured and banished. Ayah number 19. But whoever should desire the hereafter, his goal is Jannah. He is passionate about Akhirah and he exerts the effort due to it. Meaning it's not just that he wants to go to Jannah. He wants that Allah should be Razi, like happy with him. He also puts in due effort. While he is a believer, it is those whose effort is ever appreciated by Allah. The one whose goal is Jannah. You know, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when he was building the masjid with the Ansar and the Muhajirin, and the Muhajirin had just left their homes, their families in Makkah, and now they have come to Medina. They had nothing. They didn't know what the future held for them. And Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, as he building the masjid with them, he's saying, Allahumma Aisha, la Aisha al-Akhirah. Oh Allah, there is no life except the life of hereafter. Meaning, this life, you don't call this life. It's got it problems, hardship. The real life enjoyment is where? Hereafter. This life, it's very soon it's going to end. There is no ash except the life of the hereafter. Once Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said to Abu Zar radiallahu anhu that, Abu Zar, I don't wish to have gold or silver like Mount Ahad. Have you seen Mount Ahad? No. Like it's so huge. So Allah, like here Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, I don't wish to have gold or silver like Mount Uhud, except that I should spend in the way of Allah. Meaning, if I were to get it, I want to spend all in the way of Allah. And the day I die, I don't wish to have from that even a thirad with me. Not even a small amount. Meaning, I wouldn't like to keep even a little bit with me for this world. I would like to send all for the way, for the hereafter, for Jannah. Abu Zar said, Ya Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Qantara. And Qantara is big than Khirat. And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, Qintar, Khairat, I'm talking about Akhirah. I want Akhirah. And you are talking about Dinar, Dunya, Khintar, doesn't matter. Everything. So that's how Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, you know, even Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Sahaba, they used to count a thing. If something they have, they want to donate. They want to get rid of that. But we want to hoard the things in our home. That's how we are. How is our tawakkul? Ayah number 20, to each category we extend to these and to those. Meaning, dunya seeker and the akhirah seekers. Allah gives to both. From the gift of your Lord, and never had the gift of your Lord been respected. Look how we have favored in position some of them over others. But the hereafter is greater in degrees of differences and greater in distinction. La taj'al ma'allahi ilahun akhar. Ayah number 22. Do not make as equal with Allah another deity, thereby become censured and forsaken. And your Lord has decreed that you do not worship except Allah. And to parents, good treatment. This ayah talks about first not doing shirk and then be good to both parents, mother and father. Doesn't matter, they are separated, they got divorced, doesn't matter. Still, you have to be good to both parents. You can't be biased one. Because the best deed to worship Allah alone and to be good to the both parents. Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was asked, what deeds are best? He said, to perform the daily prayers at their times. To perform prayer at their correct times. And he was asked, what next? He said, to be good and dutiful to one's parents, to our parents, to our own parents. Sometimes what happens, we don't give haq to our own parents. And you know, to the person, they are not even related to your uncle or aunt. You give so much importance because they are very nice to you and you are nice to them. See, look at the parents or relatives. They are chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You didn't choose it. For the friends, you choose it. But this is the chosen by Allah. So you have to respect them. You have to take care of them. They are your responsibility, especially for the male. for the person, you know, husbands, if they are taking care of them, you have to be good to them. You shouldn't make difficult for them. Whether one or both of them reach old age while with you, meaning either your mother or your father, say not to them as much as oof. Don't even say the smallest word of irritation to them. Then what about big words, you know, loud voice and so many, so much, you know. Oof is a kalimai kariha, you know, the things which is hidden in the nails and the Q-tip. When you use the Q-tip in your ear, the dirt on the Q-tip, that is like oof, like kalimai kariha. That's how bad and evil is if you say even a small word like a oof. What about being loud, being harsh, being like, you know, very rude? We are not supposed to do that. وَقُلْ لَهُمَا قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا. But you know, you honor, you talk to them nicely, gently, in a good manner, in a controlled manner. Karima, honor them, speak to them noble words, kind words. You know how we treat our children, especially the infants one, the younger ones, even when they are grown up, then also we treat them. That's how we should treat our parents, especially when they are 60 above. That's the age when they actually enter into the old age. Whoever are 60 or above, they are actually in the old age. I'm not saying, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says there's a hadith, after 60 we are in old age and we are called to death anytime. We are called to death anytime, but that's the time he said it will be the old age. And lower to them the wing of humility out of mercy, meaning show mercy to the parents, especially when they have reached old age, they are aging, showing mercy to them, be kind to them. And beautiful dua in ayah number 24, when they are alive, then also you can make dua, and when they are dead, then also you should make dua. Not only for our own parents, for grandparents and for our in-laws, you can make this dua. Rabbi irhamhuma kama rabbayani saghira. Oh my Lord, have mercy on them as they brought me up when I was small. You know, have mercy on them as I was small. So when we were small, how they used to appreciate us. You know, many times we might have done the same mistake. Many times, you know, they change our diaper, and many times we spit our food and so on and so forth. The same thing, now they are in childhood, you know. You have to be kind and good to them. Sometimes parents, they keep on asking the same question. Sometimes they don't have the hearing, you know. Even though they put the hearing aid, they can't hear it properly. Or, you know, faculties will change, hearing, speaking and everything. You have to understand that, you know. If Allah have mercy, you will reach that age. We don't know we'll reach to 60 or not. We say so many things because right now we are young. We start saying things. Don't do that. That's not right. We have to kind to them, not only our parents, even in-laws and grandparents. So make this dua, Rabbir hamhuma kama rabbayani saghira. Every day, every time after salah, whenever you remind yourself, because especially for girls or women, they think, you know, they can't spend much time with their parents. So this is the beautiful way of making dua for your own parents. And it has so much detail, but right now we don't have, because if I start talking about this ayah, it will take a lot of time, you know, maybe 30 or 40 minutes. It has so much detail about it. But right now, just a few things I mentioned. Let's move to ayah number 25. Your Lord is most knowing of what is within yourselves, meaning He knows what you go through. For children, when you're dealing with your parents, or times when you try to hard to please them, you know, Allah knows. If you should be righteous in intention and then intended, He's ever to the often returning forgiving. Means Allah knows the state of our heart, that we are we respectful towards our parents or not. Sometimes, you know, we are very respectful, we are kind towards them, but still they have misunderstanding, or they are biased to one child and they are not good to it. Still also be good to them, give them full credit, don't be biased. In hadith we learned that Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he once passed by Abdullah bin Abi who was he? The hypocrite, Abdullah bin Ubay. So, and the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when he was passed by Abdullah bin Ubay, he said something very rude, very nasty. and his son, whose name was also Abdullah. And this shows that arrogance of this man, that he gave his name to his son. So even there's nothing wrong with the name, but it's just you about the person. He is so proud of himself that he gives exact same name that he was to his son. So his son Abdullah, he was sincere believer. Then he heard that his father said something rude and bad to Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He went to Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and said, "By the one who has honored you and revealed the book on you, if you wish, I will bring my father's head to you." You hear it? "I will bring my father's head to you." This is something really serious. But this shows that how angry this person was. And Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, "La, no. Walakin, but be good to your father. Go and be good to your father." Even though he was harsh and rude to Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, still he's saying be kind and good to the father. And Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, once a man came to him and he said that, "I want to do hijrah. Ya Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, I want to go to you, and I have left my parents weeping. They are literally crying." So Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, "Ya Raji, go back. Make them laugh as you made them weep." You know, why did you make them weep, you know, cry? Meaning when a person has made his or her parents cry, then he have to make something to make their parents happy and pleased. They have to do something to bring a smile on their face of their parents. And the disobedient child, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, "Allah will not admit in Jannah nor look at this person on the day of judgment, the one who is disobedient to his parents." So we have to be careful. Even as I mentioned, even though parents are separated, still you have to give the haq of the parents. You can't be biased one parent. Why is it? So in Surah Al-A'raf, we learn that they will be in waiting. The person who is biased to one parent because they are separated or because they didn't take care of you, even though they gave birth to you and didn't take care of you, doesn't matter. Still, you have to be good to them. Still, you have to be very nice to them. No matter what, you have to be kind and good towards your parents. Parents is such a thing that you have to understand. Parents has so much importance. And you know, after, like, especially after marriage or something, people think, "Oh, you know, I have to be," especially men's, I notice some men's, they are very biased towards one's parents. They are biased towards the, you know, like towards the woman, and they are